Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Final Show Films. I'm Sen, your executive producer. I want to thank you all for tuning in. I particularly want to thank our $25 tier supporters on Patreon. Those would be Trevian Alexander, Samantha Bates, Cat Waterflame, and Elle, without whom we wouldn't be able to do nearly as much of the things that we do. So thank you all very much for your continued support over the years. And if you're watching live, please sit back, relax, and enjoy. We're live.
Hello, everybody, and welcome once again to Shadows of the Mountain, the Werewolf the Apocalypse game that we're running here on Final Show Films. My name is Jack. I am your storyteller for this evening, and I am joined tonight by Holly.
Hey, I'm Holly. I'm playing Dakota. She is a Lupus Galliard of Tana.
And Mara.
Hi, I'm Mara. I'm playing Alexandra Kor. Metis Philodox Black Fury. That took a second.
And William?
Hi, I'm William, and I am playing Ingvar Ironblood Ulf's daughter, the Hamid Geta Fenris Arun.
And Craig?
Perfect timing.
Yeah, you put your hand up, but nobody can see you yet.
Oh, fair.
Well, they can see your hand.
Not from what I'm seeing.
Now
I know it's on a delay.
Now is my chance to make some interesting hand gestures. I am playing Gus Moraro, the Ragabot.
Gus?
Gus?
What's his name? Sal.
I think Gus is canonically his dad's name.
Oh, shit. The old man's here.
No, it's a thing when you know, you convinced Ingvar that your name was not Sel.
Oh yeah.
No. She told he told Ingvar that his name was not Salvatore. It's Salacious.
Yeah. No, it's actually Gus.
Have you also had a long week?
Yeah, it's only Wednesday. Oh boy.
Yeah, it is.
Is it?
I'm playing Salacious Moraro, Glasswalker Ragabash Hami.
And Jeremy.
I'm Jeremy. I'm playing Aiden Taylor, Hamid Philodox, child of Gaia.
And Sen?
I'm Sen. I'm playing Granya Firelight O'Connor, Hamid Glasswalker Ragabash, and local finger guns enthusiast.
And Athena?
Hi, I'm Athena, and I'm playing Mordico, Lupus the Urge, the Shadow Lords.
And as always, trans rights are human rights, Black Lives Matter, eat the rich. Down with fascists.
Happy Pride.
Listen to good music. Life is too short. Happy Pride, everybody.
Happy Pride.
And a special thank you as well to The Onyx Path, who provided us with collaboration materials for this chronicle. You can still gain access to their upcoming apocalyptic record book pre-order at apocalyptic-record.backerkit.com/hosted_pre-orders. We will pop that link in the chat and in the video description if you're watching this on YouTube. So go ahead and check that out. And when we last left the Denver region, the Wings Pack had retreated to a small forested valley. Yeah, like, follow, subscribe, comment, tell your friends. But the pack had gone to a small forested valley up past El Dorado Mountain to tend to their wounds after a run-in with the security forces fielded by Intrepid Energy. They also have a number of objectives on their horizon, most notably determining why the corporation is surveying the Thorodon Mountain region and what might be done to halt them. The Gaia's Mercs pack are still seemingly actively hunting for Aiden in the Denver area, and his old Black Spiral enemy is lurking around in the vicinity in some capacity as well. There's plenty on their plate. But we return to the campsite in the Front Range, with the Guru having at least established sources of food, water, and shelter for the short term, and now having to confront these choices that shape their immediate future. But we return to their campsite where a freshly murdered moose is resting in the shade, one might say, and Ingvar is trying to recover from an exertion of a morning.
Yeah, and to, like, whoever arrives first, it is definitely a sight of Ingvar, like, slowly peeling off bandages to try and replace them with fresh ones, because those silver bullet holes have not healed. Her hair is, like, plastered to her head with sweat. All of the braids have completely come out. Her war paint is barely hanging on. And it is quite clear that her breathing is ragged, her muscles ache. She is a mess of a guru, sort of just barely holding on, and yet she continues to push herself as she changes her own bandages, which is probably a task better suited to someone else at this point, but she's just going.
But Aiden, Moriko, and Boxcars have returned from their little spirit quest in the Umbra, so they would be the first ones arriving back.
Yep. So on site of Ingvar, Moriko is going to do that thing where she starts sort of slowly approaching. She's not really rushing or anything like that. Is Ingvar sitting down or standing?
I think she's sitting right now.
She's sitting, okay, yeah. Okay, then Moriko is at least closer eye-to-eye level. Moriko is going to look somewhere around her shin and say, "Will you allow me to help and offer out a hand?"
She kind of hesitates for a moment and then slowly just sort of reaches out a hand and takes.
Moriko is going to shift into Lupus. And she's going to try to mlem-mlem Ingvar's hand. If Ingvar doesn't pull away, she's going to heal her.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So spend and gnosis. And Moriko's going to spend a willpower. And she's going to do Mother's Touch. Oh, what's Ingvar's current rage?
Two.
Oh, sweet. 7 successes.
All right. So with the gnosis spent, just a fuck ton surge of healing energy
through
rolls through
tongue.
Your body. Yep.
Yeah. And the wounds immediately heal up. She's back to full health. And there's still the obvious signs of exhaustion that have been setting in for a while. She's still covered in sweat. Her hair is still completely damp. But the vicious wounds have closed.
Second Mordica's done, she shifts immediately in a flash to Hamid.
Damn, Doc, nice work.
Thank you.
How you feeling, Zena? You're looking better.
The wounds are gone. That is the most important part.
Is that a moose?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so about that. Damn this thing. So, you all know I'm from Jersey, right?
Yeah.
So I'm not so good with, you know, knowing my wildlife, right? So I thought I was following a deer and it, you know, I thought it might be like, what was that movie with the real short guys? Lord of the Rings, you know? And so I thought it might be like a foreshortening thing, but then we kept getting closer and I realized it was just really fucking big and just far away. By that point it was all over. And then, anyway, long story short, thought it was a deer. It was a moose. So we got a moose. Total accident, but got a moose.
It's like, I don't even give a shit. I just don't.
It's good eating on it, I think.
I will beat the shit out of you for expressly disobeying the next thing that you disobey. But I don't give a shit about this. Let's move the fuck on.
Move the fuck on?
Move.
Wow. Wow.
I'll
get a fire going.
To see if I believe him. But that's just me.
Aiden just assumes he's lying.
Yeah.
Mordigo just glares at him for a while.
Wits and empathy, difficulty 6.
Yep. Yeah.
At what
deception
point would...
manipulation and subterfuge, difficulty 6.
Yes, please.
At what point would Dakota and Grania get back?
You guys probably have about an hour.
Okay.
But we can after this roll, we can fast forward to when everybody's at home.
And I will start getting a fire going so I can start cooking parts of it. Sal does not know how to dress this thing, by the way.
Yeah. I think Ingvar will probably know how to cook and handle meat like this.
So if I'm not wrong, I add my bullshit specialization plus double my subterfuge because I'm using
if you want to use your gift, you can.
I very much do.
Okay.
Oh, whoop. It didn't give me a chance to add anything to it.
What form are you in? Because it says you have a zero, you have an attribute of zero.
That's it.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Also make sure query is on.
Let me. It's probably because I had it.
Your modifier got put in, I think, but
yeah.
And make sure your specialty is off.
Gets
done analog.
Yeah, so I add one extra to the modifier for my specialty, right?
No, that just means your tens count as 2 successes.
Your tens will count as 2 if you get 2s, but okay. you don't have the specialty applied because otherwise
there we go.
Yeah, I believe them. Okay.
Yeah, 9 successes. Yeah, right.
Yeah. If it makes a difference to Aiden, I mean, again, there's not an element to this gift of like forcing other people to believe anything. It just really looks like Sal believes what he's saying. He comes across as totally sincere.
Well, I'm impressed, and I'll go and help Ingvar.
Okay.
Amazing.
So food is made. Grania and Dakota eventually return.
With like camping gear and supplies and coolers with food
and
in
food.
It.
Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Hey guys, look, we got, what the fuck? I didn't know shopping was an option.
I mean,
that's where we went.
They literally went to go get fucking supplies.
Yeah.
Told me that.
I expressly said
and
we should go shopping.
And I definitely was not listening at that point.
We'll fucking fix that.
I don't have a time machine, boss.
No! Fix it in the fucking future! You
again,
useless fucking ragabag!
Dakota will walk in between the two of them and hand clothing the cell that she bought for him.
Yeah, no, he's not getting aggressive. He's just at the end of his fucking...
He's exasperated.
That's a nice way of putting it.
She will also hand Aiden a bottle of beer.
Thank you!
Where'd you get a moose? What?
Don't ask!
You know, damn this thing.
No, don't ask!
I don't have a time machine, boss.
What clothing is Dakota handing Seth?
She got him like what does he usually wear?
Tracksuits.
If we're not going anywhere fancy, I mean, we go fancy places, he wears designer suits. Literally any other time he's wearing tracksuits.
Then she got him tracksuits. And a tie-dye shirt.
And take the color, it's even my size. Come here.
She will hug him. Right. And you got your moose.
By accident.
I did bring you this, and she'll hand him moose jerky.
Oh, you're the best. I gotta admit, he leans over closer and whispers, your way was way easier. They're way bigger than I thought they was gonna be. I thought it was just like a deer with jowls.
And it's quite obvious from Ingvar's labored movements that she's doing what she knows, and she is like cutting this apart and getting the meat off to cook. But it's very clear that the motions are like very like just sort of like arm dropping with the cut, like very much working in exhaustion.
Hey, Ingvar, want me to cook that for you? I know a thing or three.
If you feel like it.
I will go.
Intelligence and crafts, 7.
Is intelligence and crafts or wits and crafts?
Intelligence for this one.
Previously. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
You want me to roll that too? Alex is helping as well.
Yeah. You guys can both roll. Yep. No, it would be wits and crafts if you were in a fully stacked kitchen. But at this point, you're trying to cook not exactly pre-prepared meat with definitely not all the tools and accoutrements that you
would
prefer.
Or would it be perception and crafts because you're just trying to tell when the meat is properly...
No, it's intelligence. Mm. There's more to it than just, this is not Sea of Thieves. You don't just have to watch for the color to change twice.
I have no crafts, but I'm going to roll it anyway.
All right, so you are at difficulty 8 then.
Okay.
Because that's one where the difficulty goes up if you don't have any dots.
I got one.
All right.
I don't ruin it.
2 successes. You guys managed to.
That's a green one.
You guys managed to successfully cook food. And the evening proceeds without any significant event.
Yeah. Throughout the. Oh, go ahead.
Dakota wanted to talk to Ingvar at some point.
Okay.
Yeah. And while that's going on, Mordecai's definitely going around and shoring up the which we already rolled for last time, the shoring up all the lean-tos. Everybody still got a lovely stump for themselves, essentially.
Dakota did
super comfy
tents.
Shelter.
Yeah, and none of them are healing shelters though, unfortunately. She didn't have the gnosis for it, but yeah, all of them are comfy at least.
Yeah, we brought tents, so
yeah,
we have the, if you want to do anything with those.
Like the cardboard palaces. I mean, she probably would have taken most of the tents and cardboard palace, the ones that weren't already, were falling apart.
You can substitute in tents for those. That's perfectly fine.
Yeah, some of them are definitely still lean-tos because they're still functional, but Mordecai would just take a lean-to. So anyone else who had the like, I need a tent, she would have just made that into a cardboard palace.
Comfiest tent you'll ever have. But yes, Dakota, you can find Ingvar. Mm-hmm.
Does Ingvar still look like really run down and bad?
Oh, definitely. Like the wounds are gone, but that does not, like, I don't think healing overrides exhaustion.
Okay.
Let's see the description just to be sure it doesn't say anything weird.
She will go just sit down next to Ingvar. How are you doing?
Very tired.
You should rest.
Still work to be done.
Not that much, and you should rest.
I'll rest when everything's done.
No, you'll rest now. There are others to do things. Also, you gave notes to everyone, but...
I didn't, actually. We stopped. About
three
people.
I'm assuming you did. But what about yourself?
Oh, I've got plenty of notes about myself.
You're pushing yourself way too hard. You look like you're about to collapse. And that's not going to help anybody.
And you know the notes aren't me angry at you, right?
I do now. It seemed like angry Ingvar last night, but...
I didn't even raise my voice.
It was raised a little. She will give Ingvar a hug.
She'll return it.
Do you need help with anything right now?
at some point, I need to actually finish giving notes and redo the notes that I had for everyone else.
Mm-hmm. Let's save that for morning. We brought tents. Would you like a tent?
That would be nice, yes.
And sleeping bags?
Something to lay down on would be nice.
Dakota is going to like support Ingvar and help her into a tent.
She'll lay down on a sleeping bag in a tent.
And you're going to stay there and you're going to rest until morning. Okay?
I'll do my best.
No, you're going to stay there and rest until morning. It's not an option.
She smirks.
And Dakota will stay next to her through the night.
All right. So everybody has shelter. Everybody has food. There's drinkable water. Or you can shift into Lupus and drink out of, you know, whatever the closest water feature is. Your Guru. Who gives a fuck about Gerardia?
Are we 4 days? Are we going 4 days ahead or how many?
There are a couple things that are happening tonight, and then we will be skipping 4 days ahead.
Okay. So I got to roll for the meditation.
Yep. But you sleep and you dream. Aiden, you can tell the difference between a somewhat lucid dream and being awake.
Mm-hmm.
But the scope of this dream, the setting, is the campsite. You lay down in your tent or lean-to, whichever you have. You close your eyes, you drift off. And the next thing you see, you're sitting in front of where the fire ring that you built is. It's very low light. You would swear possibly very early morning.
Okay.
Fire's out. There's a faint corkscrew of the last little bit of smoke rising from where the embers were the night before. And a fresh breeze kind of kicks up around your ears. And Dustbringer comes and perches on the stump just off to the side. He's about as big as you are right now. His wingspan is probably a good 10 feet, but he's got them folded.
I didn't do it.
That is somewhat the problem.
Okay, fair. Or maybe not.
I know your tribe. I have watched the Guru for many generations of your people.
Mm-hmm.
And it is true that the Gaians prefer their leadership be earned. And amongst their tribe, that is frequently effective.
Mm-hmm.
You do not lead Gaians here.
No, I don't.
In the city in the desert, I waited and I watched. But here, things are very different.
It's fair to say. And
there are choices that need to be made and changes that need to happen. Which of those can you see already?
As far as, I'm assuming you're talking about within our structure or in how we're doing things and not what we're doing.
Before the how comes the what.
Okay.
You have made promises. Some to your pack. Some to yourself. Some to your betas.
Mm-hmm.
Which of those will you fulfill first? Then you can decide how.
Well, we have a lot of things on our plate. Some unexpected, some escalated because of events. Ideally, be able to get it all done quickly, but obviously we can't. Right now, there's one thing in my mind that's priority, because I can fix my shit on my time until it becomes a point where fixing other shit requires me to fix my shit. So doing what I came here to do, that's tertiary to me. Handling the situation with the intrepid energy, that feels like it has an urgency that needs to be priority.
Good.
And as far as what I consider to be my obligations to the pack as a whole, well, that's a goal that doesn't end.
You outsource your leadership, Stormstone.
Interesting choice of words. How so?
This is not like the desert city. You do not have the luxury of a prophecy to guide your direction. You have a problem that needs to be faced and handled.
Mm-hmm.
If you allow everyone their turn to speak, they will use that and overlong.
Oh, yeah.
These objections and insubordination need to be addressed. And if they persist, crushed.
My patience for that has its limits.
Good. I would like to see that sometime.
All right. I assume you've heard me talking to Ingvar, talking to Mordecai.
Yes.
There's a certain point where you can't just throw them into the fire. You just have to push them through it. Don't worry, I'm getting there.
You may not have much time.
I'm getting there real quick with some people. I know.
Very well. You will need your rest.
That's fair to say.
And I have others to speak with.
All right.
And he flies away.
Good talk.
Sal, you sleep and you dream. You find yourself wandering in the woods. Looks a little familiar to where you were hunting today. but nothing really jumps out as a landmark. And then you hear off to one side the that you've come to associate with your totem spirit. Sound seems to be coming from a small clearing.
Dusty, that you?
There's no answer, but suddenly you find yourself in the open, grass spreading around you.
Fuck and forests.
Dustbringer is towering above you, probably about twice as tall as you are. And those four eyes that he has, two on either side, blink at you.
You get into my glam, bro.
So, Carpaccio.
He winces.
We must have words.
Yeah.
Do you wish to walk this world alone?
I feel like sometimes they probably ought to be better, but nah, I got shit I can do to help out here.
Do you?
I think so. I got a moose today.
You are the weak link in this pack. Did you know this?
Yeah, especially ever since we came out of here. I felt like at least fucking in Vegas. I knew what I was doing.
That is your first mistake, Carpaccio.
What, the mountains are thinking I knew what I was doing?
I bring up your old name, not because you are consuming it yourself. But because you are setting up your packmates to die.
The moose bed.
How has your packmate rope cutter been the last day?
Tense as fuck.
Bed's fault. Is that, do you know?
Well, given the nature of the question, I would assume that you want me to say me. I would argue it was the person who shot her in the face.
Rope cutter is Dakota, who did not get shot.
My bad.
You can roll that back. That's fine.
That's my bad. I Craig was confusing boxcars and rope cutter.
No worries.
All right. All right. Starting from. I assume you want me to say, he still says that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I assume by the nature of the question that you want me to say me, but it seems more like it's coming from the fact that we all got shot to hell and she got yelled at by Ingvar after. I might have dreamed that. I was kind of out of it.
You hide behind your perception of your auspice. You insist that it is your duty to object. And when your objections are not valued the way you see that they should be, you go off and do whatever it is that you please, while making the excuse that this is what the Ragabash should do.
Yeah.
You are not a free agent, Moraro. You are a member of a pack. Each time you wander off on your own independent purposes, you enable the rest of the pack to make that same decision justified in their minds. When Rope Cutter was chastised for not focusing on a single objective, that is because she learned that behavior from you. That is the lesson that you have taught your pack.
Oh, shit.
And you have been teaching that lesson very well for months.
I'm getting lectured by a lot of birds. And I kind of was thinking Technicolor was going to be the easy apology.
His demeanor shifts just slightly, and he blinks another eye at you. As far as that goes, I have been watching those who walk on two legs, and I know the agreement that you have with the dove. If you are willing to admit your ignorance and take a lesson from someone who has been longer than you, there is a secret spiritual way to determine the easiest path to make peace with you and your packmates. You go to them and you fucking ask. And you do not allow them to go easy on you for politeness and them, how is it phrased, letting you off the hook will not have the outcome you desire.
I'll be honest, Dusty, that does sound really fucking easier than what I had in mind.
Face your faults, Spider Fryer. Try simple honesty.
All right. Let's start here then, Dusty. If you know me as good as you say you know me, you know I face my fucking faults all the time. I just don't like seeing them reflected back at me in other people's eyes.
You know that command of the litany, then.
Yeah.
Do not show your weakness or let your sickness be tended. It is much easier to fulfill that rote when you yourself are aware of what your weaknesses are and accept them as part of you, not hide from them behind feeble excuses.
But then he's still kind of showing my ass when I go and admit I've done something wrong.
You cannot eliminate the weakness if you cannot admit the weakness, at least to yourself.
Yeah, like I said, that's the part I don't need help with. It's admitting it to other people. That's where it gets tricky.
But if you want peace with your packmates, there is nothing wrong with offering an alternate point of view. This is true. But once it has been offered, if it is rejected, shut up and deal with it.
You know of like a third bird that I can talk to that'll tell me to go out and get drunk and get laid or something?
These are the instructions I give you, Spider Fryer. Follow them, or I'll eat your eyeball. And you wake up suddenly.
Gus! What, God? Oh.
So now, Everybody gets some willpower back because rest is going to have been had. So everybody take a point now. And depending on how far down you are, you guys will get 3 more nights of sleep here as we burn through a few days.
Willpower ain't my issue.
Yeah, willpower is full. It's just rage that I'm low on.
Rage, but that shit's going to come back at one per day anyways also. I got the same problem as Muriko. All right.
For meditation with...
I got tons of gnosis.
Wits and enigmas. If this is your first time meditating, it's 8. If it's your second time, it's 9. If it's your third or more time, it's 10.
Yeah, she's got 3.
Roll till you botch.
Yep, she's got 3 attacks. So specialization is at 4 dots?
Yes.
Correct.
Shoot. I should have taken a specialty for enigmas. I don't have one. So I'm just going to call that 1, I guess. So she got 1.
I mean, is your enigmas at 4 dots already?
Yeah.
Do you already have a different specialty for it?
No, I mean, I haven't actually.
When you get your 4th dot, that's when you declare your specialty.
Yeah, correct. I know. And I just didn't. I got my 4th dot in the middle of, I think, last time. And I just.
Okay.
So I haven't decided on it yet. So I'm just going to, I don't think it's meditation anyway.
Okay.
It might be, it could be, because it would kind of fit the character, but I really need to actually look at what.
Okay. What your options are there and whatnot.
I am also rolling this.
Sure thing.
I'll
try twice 2. A day.
Oh,
there's
the botch.
Yep. So then how long is it until she can meditate again?
I got 2.
That's your last one for the week. So if you botched on your last roll of the week, then technically you're kind of okay.
Yeah, no, she's close. She gets, right. And then, okay, so she's 2 days and then she'd be back at 8.
Yep.
And then she'd only have that 1.
Yep. Remember, you do have to have dots and enigmas if you're going to do this, because it's in the knowledges tab.
Why do I not have? Oh, I guess I didn't put dots in the weird.
All right, and then she had 2 more successes.
Okay.
Last day.
Add those to your gnosis pool. That's an enigma. It's a puzzle.
It's a puzzle. Or it goes good with puzzles.
All right. Anybody else doing meditation?
I tried, but I got 0, which I think tracks.
Okay, that's fair.
Ingvar's actually low on gnosis.
So to be clear then, if you don't have enigmas, you can't get gnosis back.
Not by meditating.
Not by meditation.
Like, yeah.
You can hunt. You can
get it through one of the ways that takes an hour or so of role play then.
Technically, yes. Based on how the W20 rules are.
Very useful.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Nope. That's why when Mordico ran out of meditation options, it was... gonna go eat a spirit's gnosis, I guess.
Yep.
It was intelligence enigmas, you said?
Wits enigmas. Wits enigmas. Your first roll is at 8, your second one is at 9, and then 10s.
Are you implying, Jeremy, that there is a...
I'm implying that in order...
...in World of Darkness that is convoluted?
No. I am implying that what is normally a perfectly fine rule for... what is a standard roleplay group, which is like 3 or 4 players in a session where you can role play for like 5 or 6 hours, doesn't translate well to 7 people in 3 hours session.
I'm impressed, Ingvar. I can't believe you got 2 successes with 3 die.
Well, she's almost back to full on gnosis. She's only 2
nights
down now. Yeah, no, that's awesome.
Ingvar, if you're going to take the hike to set up the shrine, that is a stamina and athletics roll at difficulty 7.
Yes. Stamina, athletics.
If you are taking anybody with you, they need to make the same roll as well, because there was something said about nobody going anywhere alone.
Difficulty what? Difficulty 7. What? 7.
I'll wait for our boss to tell us who has to go with it.
Where are you going?
Up to the top of a mountain to plant a shrine.
For the bear spirit.
Right.
So, Val had offered to come when we were walking the other day. I mean, when we were hunting.
Sure, that'll be fun. Climb a mountain.
All right. Do either my strength reserves or unbreakable specialties in strength and stamina apply to this?
Yeah, one or the other. It doesn't really matter which.
So, six successes.
Six successes. Cool. But yeah, no, if Sal wants to go with, that's stamina athletics. Difficulty 7.
I'm a mountain Jersey boy.
All right.
Really, Alex?
Yes.
Really?
Can I shift?
Yeah.
Weird. That's the song that Grania sings while she's cooking.
Where's my shifting button?
Stamina Primal Urge. Six.
And Ingvar is notably doing the entire hike in Hamid just as a
as a veil precaution.
Well, not only as a veil precaution, but as a like, I shouldn't be making this easier on myself. The point is the challenge.
Okay. Valid.
Ingvar is being Ingvar.
Stamina Primal Urge. I'm in Hamid, so it's 6, right?
6. Yep. Mm-hmm.
All right. All right.
Gonna hike in Krynos?
I am not.
Okay.
It's not a bot. I'm just chilling in
not yet, it's not.
And now I'm in Hispo, so it's one more.
Aren't you over ragey as it is?
Whoa. Why are you still rolling 5 dice if you're in Krynos?
Oh shit.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Make sure you shift. You've got a ton of extra stamina.
All right. Should I stay in
so your first 2 successes got you to Krynos. That's where you're starting. Mm.
Okay. Alright. Now that's
not
a botch.
That's not a botch. There's a 10 in there.
There's a 10 in there. That's a success. That's just a failure. Try it again.
There we go.
There you go. Alright. Okay. So, yep. You can make your stamina athletic 7 in lupus.
Alright.
I need you to think about that sentence there, Jack.
That's, I know.
Just a success, it's still a failure.
Yep.
World of Darkness, everybody.
Hey, or Star Wars, to be fair.
I was just going to say, yes. Life, man.
That makes
what a
as
mood.
Much sense as anything else that's not D&D.
Just, what a mood, man. What a mood.
Two.
All right. So, yeah. Two of you take a brisk but long hike up to the top of a mountain where Ingvar establishes a small shrine to Bear and safely make your way back to the camp afterwards.
Brisk but long is the name of my sex tape.
She sort of arranges it with like the stone of her lineage placed in front of it as like a protective symbol, like mm-hmm. this shrine is here under my protection, and anyone who fucks with it deals with me.
Yep. Valid.
That looks real nice. Yogi's gonna be real pleased.
I think he'd be less pleased if you heard him call him that. If you heard you call him that.
I doubt he watches Hanna-Barbera. Still, real good job.
All right. Anything anybody else is doing before the 4th day?
I will tell. I would have told after while cooking after we got back. I meant to say this, but I dropped it for a second. We'll tell Aiden and the rest about my run-in with the other Glasswalkers.
Okay.
Yep.
That information was exchanged. That name, name and number has been exchanged. Right. I got a line to him.
Give me the number.
Give him the number.
Thank you.
Yep.
And one of those names was important to to Aiden, I believe.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Martinez.
Yeah.
Would I?
Yeah, Aiden will. Okay. Go ahead.
I was gonna say, would there have been a reaction to the name Martinez?
Oh yes. Yes.
An obvious one.
An obvious one.
Okay. He's not trying to hide it.
Yeah, no, he's not. Okay. He is past the point of that at this point.
Right. Okay.
And he will explain that we're sort of racing through this. Martinez, there are only, I mean, he's making a guess at this point, but it's a fairly, there's probably only so many Glasswalkers named Martinez.
Uh-huh.
In Denver,
probably.
One of the people who died at Owl in the Moon was a Glasswalker kinfolk that was sort of an unofficial kinfolk of the pack, named Jesse. And there is, he doesn't know anybody else in the family really very well, but there was somebody, her name was Natalie. She was 16 at the time, and she sort of idolized Jesse and saw the pack largely through Jesse's eyes, so really looked up to the pack, and he hasn't seen her since. He is on the list, or she is on the list of people he needs to talk to.
Mordico knows of another Glasswalker, last name Martinez, that's an active guru in the sept, which is Lupe Martinez, who goes by Override. She is a member of the Mountain's Blood Pack.
Mountain's Blood Pack?
Mountain's Blood Pack, which is the pack that is led by the Sept Elder that is a member of the Gaia, the Child of Gaia tribe.
I also would have mentioned that this area that we're in now is the area where the missing pack went missing in.
Good to know.
Very rough general region, not like we're camped where it was. They disappeared on the west side of the city somewhere, which is technically the region you guys are in.
Which did Mordico know that already?
Yeah, Mordico was aware of that too.
She's gonna pass on the information she has. She's gonna be looking mostly at Aiden while she does it, but she's gonna pass it on in just the very bare bones potential.
All right, so Ingvar, we're setting up watch. We're setting up watches then for sleep.
Definitely.
But we actually have to get into specifics. But yeah,
is Mordico also doing her tracking rights every night
every
as well?
Night. Okay. Yep.
Do you track both people every night, or
okay? Because those are the two that are the most dangerous to us.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Let me roll for that.
Yeah.
I need my Rite of the Questing Stone. And it's still 7? Yeah, it's still 7 because it's a thing. Okay. 4 successes on Isabel, because you'll do Isabel first. Do you want me to roll these for every night, please?
You can just make one roll for Isabel over the 4 days, and one roll for Flighthide over the 4 days.
I was saying, that's gonna be so many rolls.
Right, yeah.
Yep, so 4 on Isabel and 3 on
Flighthide.
On Blackhide.
The Black Spiral is mostly to the south of you, going back and forth to an extent. Sometimes he's a little more southeast, sometimes he's a little more southwest, but that's generally what you can tell.
He's not really moving anywhere within our range or up into Denver.
Not directly within your range. Isabel is all over Denver. But the very last night, she is camped out in Golden, which is sort of the last big town before you head are at right now.
Yeah.
Somebody heard of a fire.
I was just going to say, that's the one where Mordecai usually does this at night, right before bed. She's going to go up to Aiden. Is Aiden in tent or lean to?
Probably tent.
Okay. Yeah, she's going to go up to his tent.
Blame my Boy Scout.
Background.
Your background.
I'm more comfortable in tents than lean tos.
Yep. Yeah. So yeah, she's going to do the thing.
Show me somebody who isn't, and I'll show you a liar.
That is also fair. here's the thing about the difference between the two.
Sure.
I was going to say, Monica's more comfortable.
Show me a human.
Legit.
There you go. Yeah,
here's the difference between the two. Yeah, the lean-to looks a lot better if you haven't slept in both. To a human.
Oh yeah, no, just more to go.
It looks better.
This is so much nicer.
But you're hoping that nobody else knows that the tent is where you actually want to sleep.
Mm-hmm. All right. So yeah, so Mordecai will go up to Aiden's tent on that last night where she gets the very new, very different information about Isabel. And she is going to very, very quietly call out his name and kind of scratch at the tent.
He comes out. opens it up. What's up?
That's not an in-character laugh. That's just me because of the last time he said sup. Sorry. Hold on. Just need a second.
Wait, what was the last time he said sup?
When you stuck your head out into the front seat of the armored vehicle.
So my brain is just replaying that.
And Krynos Granya is there at the wheel.
Oh, no, I was in Hamid form. No.
I was in Krynos.
Yeah, he was in Krynos.
Oh, that's right.
Granya was in Hamid.
Yeah, I
know. Kind of hard to drive in Krynos.
Yeah, no,
we had opposite personalities at the moment, though.
Correct.
Yes. So, that was just my...
That's fair.
That was my out-of-character laughter.
I think I have a trademark Aiden move. Awesome.
Lean head in, sup.
Okay. Yep. Lean head. We'll say so. Okay. So Mordecai is going to look. She looks very serious. I mean, yes, I know. Very, very unusual from her usual.
Right. What a change.
Yes. What a change.
What a twist.
Aiden. Isabel has moved much closer. She's probably in Golden.
Well, fuck. I mean, it's not like I didn't expect. I'm surprised it took this long. We literally put a here's where we are in fire sign.
Yes.
But
she has had time to make a strategy of what she would like to do.
Do you hear it? She sure has.
What do you want to do?
We're going to have to move. I'm not... For a lot of reasons, I'm not confronting her yet. To be clear, I'm gonna at some point, maybe a long time down the road, but I'm going to at some point.
My concern is that she will be at our back while we go forward.
Uh-huh.
Right now, I know exactly where she is. Once she starts moving into the forest, there will be less and less opportunity to determine where she is.
I've got an idea. It's going to require you. Probably you.
Noted.
And you're going to have to get face to face with her.
Understood.
I need you to go to her. And he reaches into the tent, comes out, because we've got Sal and through all the supplies runs of, we've got a couple burners at this point, right?
You're muted, Jack.
So here's the thing. I'm going to give Granya a chance to have tinkered with the radio a bit on this 4 days.
Nice.
Because you guys brought that with you, I believe.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Granya, give me an intelligence and technology. Stated difficulty is 8. Apply your merits as needed if they lower it.
-2 for computer.
This would be
hardware.
Technology. Hardware is technology. So yeah.
Yeah.
Intelligence and tech drops by 2, so then you're at a 6.
Where's my engineering? Would my industrial sabotage specialty apply?
No, you're not sabotaging this. You're trying to see what sort of technological sophistication they have and make some diagnostic / evaluative decisions from there.
I would argue that repurposing your enemy's technology for your own uses is part of sabotage, but that's fair. What difficulty would you say originally?
It was originally 8, so I think that drops it to 6.
7, 6, yeah.
Okay.
Two successes.
Based on the level of tech that they've got here on their field radio, you're able to extrapolate a little bit and running over in your mind what sort of things that they have at their disposal and what you've seen so far. You have been able to confirm that basically they had localized communications, but those communications were getting routed to another location.
Yeah.
This stuff that they have is fairly proprietary. Like, they probably built this communications in-house. This is not something that they, you know, mass ordered from, you know, comms R Us or anything.
They manufactured it.
This is a hand-built unit, which means that they're familiar with parts, sourcing them, and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
They captured at least two of your drones the very first time you tried to investigate. Drones that you know were purchased with Sal's credit card.
Yeah.
And then they found the house that was also paid for with Sal's credit card. Sal should not be buying anything.
Mm-hmm.
Sal used cash on all that shopping trip.
You specifically stated that you had cards.
To be clear.
And that you were using them.
I was asking specifically in regard to basically Grania and Dakota's trip.
Yeah, no, this is just information that would be coming out.
Yeah. You did say so.
Because
because
there was specifically a statement that this was not something that you would have enough cash on hand to buy.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because as many resources as you have, it can't all be cash.
That's okay. Yeah.
So as far as burner phones go, I would have bought several burner phones because I use those as detonators.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So there will be outside of Grania's bucket, outside of Grania's tent, there'll be a bucket with a bunch of like random Nokia phones in it.
Perfect.
A sign that says take one, throw it away.
Like, absolutely perfect. So Aiden would like get up, walk like sort of half dressed over, grab one, hand.
Note, the bucket is completely full because there is zero reception out here, so nobody's had a need to use one yet.
I'm fully aware.
Right.
I would have passed along after making that connection, A, the information, and then B, if anything that we buy is going to end up in the vicinity of enemies, it needs to be bought with cash, not with credit.
Yep.
Not with traveler's checks, not with anything else, because they will trace it back.
Yep. But yeah, walks over, grabs one, walks over, hands it to Monaco.
Mm-hmm.
I need you to deliver this. He stops, he opens it up, looks at the cell number, programs the cell number into his phone. I need you to deliver this to her.
Understood.
And then I need you to let me know once she has it, because I am going to contact her by phone. You can't fucking issue a challenge to somebody by goddamn cell phone. And I'm going to tell her, look around. Is anybody else around here? Or is it just me and Morocco currently?
I mean, this would be at the very end of the day. So like after everyone goes away is when Morocco does her right of the questing stone, because she has to concentrate.
I mean,
I'm going to.
If you're next to my tent, I'm in the tent.
Okay. I'm going to. He would move back, because he moved back towards where? Back to his tent. I'm going to promise her, and I intend to keep this, that once we handle the situation that we're working on, which is a situation involving killing the worm and killing one of the people who's directly responsible, one of the spirals, that I will go to her and I will stop trying to run from her.
Understood.
As long as she backs off and lets us do this.
That is your term.
That is my term.
If she does not agree.
If she doesn't agree, we're good. Once you hand her the phone, leave. Once you hand her the phone, actually, once you see her pick up my phone call, leave.
if they will not allow me to leave until they have an answer, what would you have me do? I can run fairly fast.
You know what?
I have a brand new sniper.
Take Rania with you.
I would prefer your Philodox for bargaining, but Grania will be. If you will have us fight our way out if we are confronted, she can do a lot of damage and distraction.
I'm hopeful.
Well.
I am hopeful currently that her anger is focused largely on me, maybe residually on the on the group of us who came up north, and that you guys have the least residual anger. That's why I'm saying Gron.
I may be able to convince her you do not care about us in particular.
I am also Agreed. Okay with you making that, with you implying that. But if need be.
Pack.
If need be.
Yes, I understand.
But yeah, that is my goal. If she refuses, then we just get to play avoid the angry get for the next. Because there's no better option now. My hope is that if we can handle what needs to be handled, and that for some inexplicable reason, because the Gru Nation is what the fucking Gru Nation is, that they are not willing to tackle this. I'm sure there are good reasons individually, but that if we can handle this and if we can deal with this situation, we will have won enough goodwill that when I finally do come face to face with Isabel, it's in a much more equitable situation where she can't just murder me.
I will do what I can.
I appreciate that.
Tomorrow morning.
Sounds good.
And she's gonna leave. She doesn't like say goodbye or anything like that. She just.
All right. And that's where we're going to take a quick break.
All right. If you're watching live, please stay tuned for these commercial messages. And if you're not, well, I mean, no, if you're watching, I completely lost that. If you're watching live, please stay tuned for these commercial messages. Otherwise, when we take our break, you take your break, stand up, stretch your legs, move around, do whatever you need to do. We'll be back in just a few minutes. We're back. A dinosaur story.
Hello. Welcome back. Here we are. All right. So, Isabel is somewhere down in Golden, Colorado. Yipers. And we will say that over the last couple days, you guys have also had some time to talk strategy. So let's do that real quick now, especially now that this whole Isabel thing is also on the board for consideration.
Oh, all right. Is that
and we can assume these conversations happened in various sections over time, et cetera, and, you know, things were revisited and blah, 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 blah.
That on periodically. The board for consideration as opposed to just Moriko grabbing Kanye and disappearing in the morning?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay. So we'll let the alpha lead off with that.
Yeah.
Okay. So we've got a lot on our plate currently. Number one priority is clearly Intrepid and what they're dealing with.
The wild and all that.
Exactly. What they're digging for, what's down there, everything in relation to that. Because if they're trying to dig something up, it's not good. Yeah. We need to know what that is.
Do you think any one of us could convince the cairn that, you know, an entire pack coming under attack by a group of people with bane-ridden Femora and silver bullets would be enough to get a little bit of interest? Since it's now more than just me getting shot?
I'm going to be honest. If one of the Sept leaders' packs was in this area, they have vanished. And Monaco expressed this issue that was also in this area, the Sept aren't dumb. They know it's related. Us being attacked by a worm, by something spiral, or the banes and the like, is a drop in the bucket compared to that pack being gone. Is it worth reaching out? Yes. If we have someone we can reach out to safely. So I think that anything's going to come of it? No.
Yeah, Moriko's going to step forward at that one and then say, it is also a danger that Gray Snow may decide that our actions have aggravated their investigations.
Also that.
We could be ordered, all of us, to cease, and then I have no loophole left. Take that as a possible ending.
I mean, your loophole at that point is if we are at some point explicitly ordered to stand down, I'm going to say no.
Yes.
And then
we will be in conflict.
We will be, but also you dedicated yourself to Dustbringer, whose concept is loyalty, and you don't think I'm corrupt.
I have no concern myself. I dedicated myself to this task.
Correct.
I will see it done.
Correct.
One way or another, but it may be more difficult. It is something to consider. That they may not have help to give, only fewer resources we can use.
Correct.
Sal has a hand raised.
I'm afraid to ask, but shoot.
What did Aiden say?
I'm afraid to ask, but shoot.
Permission to speak freely, boss?
Within reason.
All right, I'll give it a shot. How likely is it? I think we sort of brushed on this briefly once before, but how likely is it
that at least one person back in the can here is in on it.
Is in on it?
Yeah.
Would Mortigo have a read on that, Jack, from her own time looking into this?
You can give me a wits and enigmas difficulty 10.
All right. Perfect. Please. Is it 10?
Yep.
Just saying.
Please botch.
Far from the first time we've had
somebody. Yeah. Triple botch.
Triple botch.
Wow.
Amazing. Mortigo, with absolute and complete. It's not possible.
Or it's everyone.
Okay, yeah, no, that's what I say. It's either none of them or all of them.
All of them.
All right, Mirko, with all due respect, that Shadow Lord thinking, and I respect it, but
it's so Shadow Lord wrong. Thinking. It's so Shadow Lord thinking. It's fantastic.
But in this case, it's wrong.
Fuck, I might even be in on it.
Yeah! With a triple botch, I almost want to say she's almost am like, I points.
You Shadow Lord did too close to the sun. Yeah. No.
And she, again, she's not laughing. This is, yeah, this is just
for sure.
It could be you. It could be me.
Yes. That's basically
what nobody, she's doing. Nobody devil's advocate this. No, I don't. Is it possible? Yes. It's been a long time since I've been around these people, and I don't know who's new. I don't know. Is it possible? Yes. Is it likely? I would say probably not. But at some point in my life, I was an optimist. And for some reason, y'all seem to be determined to bring that back. So I don't know for sure.
Right. I know from personal experience that it's possible to have even people that you respect turn out to be in the pocket of the worm. And like you said, you've been away for a while. And all right, I don't know the lay of the land here. So you tell me if I'm totally off base here, but this is kind of fucking weirding me out that we can have this much of a brush with this much worm taint and nobody gives a fuck.
I think, to be honest, I think they care very, very much. And they're paralyzed with indecision. Or they have somebody looking into it behind the scenes. Either way, I don't think that that's why I don't think we're going to get much help. Because either they're not willing to step out to do it, or they're already doing it and like was said, the idea of us bumbling our way in is something that they'll want to quash.
Do you think they're afraid?
Yes.
Yes.
They're either afraid or they don't know.
All focus has been on recovering the elders.
Because
we may run into someone here because this is where they will go.
That's their point.
Well, I guess my thought is, do they think that the black spirals are the reason that their elders are missing? Or do they think someone in their elders' pack was working with the black spirals? There's no way to have that information. Even with being afraid of dealing with the problem, it still seems like really, really, really weird for nobody to be more interested in fighting this threat than doing anything else.
Intrepid energy did not seem, in the words of the Master of the Rite, did not seem anything more than a tool, perhaps, of the worm, not a head of it.
Well, yeah, that's why I figured maybe telling them about, you know, the Famori and Bane Riddens that we fought off with explosives might make their tune change a little bit more.
Correct.
Or reveal more about their position.
They may, and yes, because it is me, they may see it as a need to remove us from that hunt. That is all I caution. They are not unaware of the danger here. They simply do not believe they are connected. I did. I made my case. It was rejected.
I'm going to be honest here. I don't think they're unaware of what we're doing. This sept, no, this sept is a competent sept. We're not, we caused a fire and large explosion that caused governmental helicopters to show up.
No.
Governmental and non-governmental. And we've had run-ins with people from the sept. Various people of us have. I think they know where we are, and if they know where we are, they know what we're doing, because there's only one reason we're going to be coming here. So I think, to be perfectly honest, that they are in a situation right now where they hope that we succeed in whatever we're doing. But if we don't, it doesn't hurt them one bit. And my concern is, if we reach out, and that destroys that illusion. Correct. They don't have plausible deniability anymore.
I agree.
Just like a Suicide Squad situation?
Yes, we are the Suicide Squad. Now, there is one person that we can potentially reach out to get information about what's going on in the sept. And that would be other Dakota. She's a person in standing within the sept. High in standing in the sept. She probably has some idea of what's going on, and she would be willing to give information to us potentially under the radar. I'm a little concerned about her involving her in this for making things more difficult for her, but I honestly feel like we've gone beyond that. So I think we need to make contact with her, find out what's going on with the sept, and we need to find out more of what's going on with where they're digging. Because we know the basics with Intrepid. I don't think there's anything else until we're in full assault mode time. That scouting them out is going to help much, unless by scouting them out, we can find out what they're digging for.
I mean, yeah, by scouting them out, we can get their information, because the dig site's going to be more guarded. Or at least, well,
we don't need to go to the dig site. We need to talk to people with a much... Oh, shit.
Yeah,
we need to talk to people that have a much deeper memory of the lore of this city that is not common knowledge.
Actually,
would Moriko know who that is, Jack? Like off the top of her head, of like who would be really historical historian?
I mean, were he still alive?
Okay, yeah. But
otherwise, likely the Master of the Rite, mm-hmm. or one of the elders.
Mm-hmm.
Hawks is keeper of the land, so she is much more focused on the actual cairn itself.
Yeah. She doesn't feel like a historian.
Right.
Yeah,
based on, I mean, there's also... I mean, Will is local and kind of old as fuck. Maybe. Yeah, Will would definitely be the person you'd talk to be like, hey, do you know anything about this? Or do you know any spirits around here who know anything
right,
about this?
Right, but she already knows they're bargaining from a position already of negative, right. So she would not suggest them.
And he's already been unwilling to give information until we prove our cause anyways.
Yeah, so no, like...
I've got a really bad idea, Jack.
Yep.
Having been here a while in the past, how old is this sept?
About a century-ish.
What is the totem spirit for this sept?
Jesus Christ.
The totem spirit for this sept is one of Bison's brood.
I've got a really fucking bad idea.
Noted.
Isn't that the only kind of idea you ever have?
If we want to know what's truly going on in the history of things way long past, we need to talk to the most powerful, oldest spirit we can in this area. And the best thing I can think of, anybody got any ideas for sneaking into the sept and talking to the totem spirit?
I mean,
yeah.
Yes.
Ragabash's grinning. Yeah. Both Ragabash's.
Sal grins as well and says, I think New Coke and Classic got that one covered, boss.
I was going to say, though, to give us an idea that isn't the worst, best idea, we don't need to go to their current dig site to find out what they're digging for. Not necessarily. If we go to a failed dig site, we might be able to work out from things they left behind what they're looking for. And
Jack, are there any failed dig sites, or are they all still in the same locations that they were originally?
You know of four dig sites that they have set up. They haven't been here that long, and all four of them are still active.
Yeah, okay, that's what I was going to say. Like, I Mordico would have definitely already
Three dig sites and a home base, actually.
Yeah. Grania would already have that information for sure, Sen. But Mordico, there's no failed dig site.
So I know, I would know that they have three dig sites, and I would know that basically the full amount of information that we got from Moriko about those, if I'm remembering wrong, please correct me, was that the dig sites are there, and that there's something wrong, but Moriko doesn't really actually know what's going on in each dig site.
Correct, in the sense that like they have been digging, they have not been here very long. There is no failed site yet, though. There's no way to know that they're not all in a correct location at this point. They're not super far away.
But there's no place that they've been exploratory and then left.
Yeah, none at all. All of them.
Yeah, they're all of them are still occupied.
Yeah. And Grania would have that information 100%.
That doesn't work. Never mind then.
All right, so it's breaking. It's a sept heist, then, is what I'm hearing.
I mean, unless any of the dig sites are less guarded than the others, but.
Hey, Jack, we've got our title for next week's episode.
Mordico is going to step forward. I have a suggestion, then.
I'm excited to hear this.
I would not recommend sending in two Ragabashes to speak to a totem.
Oh, no, you're going.
I will go, but I am not. Grania, what is the word?
Give me an adjective.
From last time when I ruined everything. And she's referring to that time.
In good standing?
No, when she's ruined the time before where Mordico is not stealthy.
Yeah, I was going to say subtle.
Oh. You have the walking gait of a colossus, I think is the way to describe it.
That, but I know a glasswalker who made my mirror shades, who would be willing to make something that would let me walk in the shadows with your shadow walkers.
Can I have their number? Because I really want to get me a pair.
Yes.
I can get a number. Oh, good.
I was going to say, she's going to give the name of the glasswalker who's
her name is Frostmage.
Yep, I was going to say, her name is Frostmage. Right.
Good thing. And that's the one. The
yeah, and she's going to be talking about a Nyx bangle. And yeah, Mordecai would already have that number, I think, but she doesn't actually.
Didn't they give Frostmage's number when they had that conversation earlier?
Was Frostmage one of
Frostmage's name was mentioned? I don't know.
Yeah, Frostmage wasn't in that one. I think
Frostmage wasn't there, but Frostmage is part of is what was get, someone I didn't they get mentioned Frostmage's as someone
number.
Who
makes no, I got yeah. Yeah. I got
Hard Knocks and Curb Stomp Fatalities
yeah.
number.
Yeah, yeah. Hard Knocks' number, yeah.
Mordecai would know this. Yeah, Mordecai would know her number though for sure, but she would definitely just give the name as well.
Oh, that's like, part of the Glasswalker crew.
Yes.
Crash Fantastic Pack.
All right.
I have worked with them before. They
oh, that's good. Have actually, many that's actually jokes. Good. That means I don't need to hot. That means I don't need to hotwire their bedpans.
I would not stop.
Please don't hotwire anybody's bedpans.
I was going to say, Mordecai's still bitter about the sunglasses. It's fine.
Should we?
All right. Well, that'll get you guys in.
Sorry, what was that, Craig?
No, Jeremy was talking.
Oh, I was going to say that. I just said that'll get you guys in. Mm-hmm. And then he pauses to think. So go ahead.
Can we reach out to Will? I mean, we got this situation where he asked us to get him some actual intel. I think fucking Bane-ridden Fomor and the whole thing that went down, that might...
That's already been communicated. No, it simply put us further in debt because we also caused police action on his territory.
About the fox, what the fox said, and
oh my god,
what we're doing.
Oh my the fox
god! Oh my god.
No!
I'm so sorry, Mara.
Aiden even just goes.
What the fox said.
Yep.
Okay.
Sorry. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Sorry, Mara. I have a kid, and that just viscerally shot me back like 5 years. We have what the fox said.
Sorry, go ahead.
That is new information that he doesn't know.
Remind me. Oh, that they're digging. What they're digging for is something ancient and powerful, and
yes,
blah blah blah.
Or we can wait until after Moriko and get back from hopefully talking.
I think it's worth it to try and see if we can figure out exactly what it is.
Do you want us to question? Do you want us to talk to the Karen Spirit before or after we talk to Miss Kills a lot?
Funny story. Had a thought. No, that's a bad idea. Never mind.
Did you want someone to distract her and her pack while someone else was sneaking in to speak to the Cairn spirit?
I mean,
I don't see that.
It wouldn't be bad to have a distraction. She's not the guardians. We need to distract the guardians.
Mordecai would have pointed that out, that her pack is not a guardian pack.
Hey boss, if New Coke and Doc are going to be sneaking in, probably don't need double the hotness on that one. If you need somebody distracted and thinking about other things, A.
A isn't like an into a sentence. It's like an emphasis.
It is where I'm from.
It is the end of a sentence.
If it wasn't obvious, he's also like pointing at himself with both hands.
Yeah.
I can assist in distracting.
Oh, Technicolor, I mean, I love to have you along, but I mean, I'm thinking this is the kind of like piss somebody off or get them thinking about other things. And I mean,
And I was thinking of being there if something went wrong.
Yes.
I agree with the Galliard. We could do this a different way.
Nobody's doing any of this alone.
All right.
Just before we get too far into our cups I think possibly we should not try to deal with both of these problems at the same time.
No.
We can't.
This isn't the Isabel thing.
Yeah. Okay.
We need to distract the guardians.
Yeah. My initial question about whether or not we want to deal with somebody else first was Isabel. If we want to talk to her first.
Oh yeah. No, I'm gonna talk with her.
We must talk.
Because if I can get her off of our trail, that makes trying to sneak into the sup that much easier.
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
Good. No, absolutely.
Yeah. I was like, Grani and Moriko should really start going though, because we want to make sure we get that one in before we get to the next step.
Yeah,
I mean, so Mordecai would point out daylight's burning.
If we should wait a day.
Go, yes. So yeah. you guys go. When you go, bring the cell phone. Take it to Isabel.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Two birds, one stone.
Let me get a few things. But if we know what we want to do, if we know what our plan is going to be going into the cairn, then we might be able to get information or look out for opportunities while we're dealing with her too. So I want to get that ironed out before we go.
We'll see. I'm not going to try to sneak too much information out of her because that would.
Oh no!
Passive observation.
I do
not have enough to bargain with to get information, as well as time.
Yeah.
Mordecai's going to go grab that phone, and she's going to probably. I think she can probably string it on her little necklace. And Jack, if she strings it onto her necklace when she shifts, is that going to be that the necklace changes with it and the cell phone is still attached to it, or is that going to fuck with it?
We can say nah in this case.
Yeah, because the necklace is part of her, is dedicated to it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and she's just going to string it so that the cell phone's not going to be like usable or anything or larger. Mm-hmm. It's just going to be, just attaching it.
She'll be basically wearing a slight collar with a cell phone hanging.
Yeah, like very weird looking wolf, but yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, and then whenever Grania grabs, they grab, and then Mordecai's going to shift into Lupus, and she's probably going to try to run to Golden. Because we don't have any transportation at this point, right?
Grania's got her vehicle now.
Yeah. Oh, you do? Okay, yeah. Well then, yeah, never mind then. Yeah, she's just going to hang out then in Hamid.
It's not immediately next to us, but it's in the area.
Yeah, but they get to it? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You guys can get to the vehicle.
I'm going
to
grab a laser pointer, a high-powered laser pointer. Like targeting laser, and a couple of mirrors and some duct tape.
Nice. You know they're canine based and not cats. You can't.
I was gonna say, are you kidding me though?
I will also point out that dogs also go crazy for laser pointers.
Yes, they do. So do fish, by the way.
I'm not gonna be using it like that.
Yeah, she's gonna use it like
as I pull out yet another cell phone and a prism.
All right.
Yeah.
You want reinforcements in a can? Okay. Yeah, reinforcements in a can.
Yeah. And Monica will make it clear that she's going to go try to bargain. Don't interfere unless she gives the signal, and the signal will be that she makes direct eye contact with Isabel. That means she's having trouble with Isabel.
Could you give me a slightly less subtle signal than that?
Nope. Although you will be able to tell because she knows she doesn't make eye contact. She's going to have her head down.
I will figure something out.
It was parked across the city. Yeah.
Muted, Craig.
Yeah, Grania's Jeep was parked across the city when the explosives went off, and then we went.
Yeah, I appreciate the reminder. It was being bait. That was the.
Yep.
Those were the 2 weeks I was out, so I listened to all that very fast and very tired, but so
valid.
Yeah.
Okay.
So a handful of mirrors, some duct tape, and laser pointer or targeting laser.
And then they're gonna head into Golden, and Jack. Mordecai's just going to do that thing that she does where she just doesn't care that people think she's weird. And she's just going to start asking literally anyone she runs across if they've seen Isabel specifically.
You also can do your right
little question if you want. Okay.
Yeah.
I was like really, really close by. All right.
Yeah.
Let's see if she gets it.
After they leave, Ingvar will note will note to Aiden. If we're about to be heading into dangerous territory, I will note that I am currently down my greatest tool for battling the worm specifically.
We're not going into battle yet. You have a very valid point. I mean, we're not going into battle against the worm. We might be going into battle against
my greatest tool for fighting anything that isn't the weaver.
I don't really want you using your fang dagger on guardians if it comes to that.
It's fair, although in that particular case, my greatest weapon for dealing with other guru is actually speaking.
Yeah.
I am a fair hand at conversation with other guru.
No, I aim to get that back. We just need something that we can take to Will. That's big enough. And I think whatever, finding out whatever they're digging for will be big enough that we can be like, fuck you, give it back.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say, Jack, can I try that Rite of the Questing Stone again, but with it an increased difficulty?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Let's see if this works.
Bump the difficulty up by one.
One success.
I'm also going to be asking around, but more subtly, you know, like, hey.
Oh, no, I said, no, before they start asking, she's going to write a questing stone, because I didn't know that it was going to give her more information that would be that close, because general doesn't help them. She needs, like, an actual location.
Gotcha.
But if she can get the rite of the questing stone, then before she starts asking, she'll try.
And I think the rite of the questing stone basically gives you, like a compass objective on a video game where it just, like, points the general direction.
Pretty much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and as long
so
as
the closer you get, the more accurate it gets. Like, this way, that way.
Yep, and she's probably just going to get closer and closer to where Isabel's going to be, and then look for the most logical location, and she's got quite a bit in Enigma's intelligence, wits, and perception for figuring out what's the most logical place for somebody like Isabel that she knows at least something about to have stayed.
Okay. So you guys get down to Golden, driving around, following your questing stone. And with what you know of Isabel, she tends to, she's a Galliard, but she's a Get Galliard. So you know she has a tendency for areas that give a level of tactical advantage, but also kind of make for a good story as well. Balancing that sort of battle and bardic nature of her auspice and her tribe. So you are not super surprised when the questing stone leads you to a fairly large building. It basically looks like an abandoned warehouse. And the chain that was holding two double doors closed has been freshly broken, you can see.
All right, Mordico is going to take the lead, which is unusual for her. And she is going to enter that location with, oh, hold on. How much gnosis does she have? Oh boy.
Really quickly.
Go ahead.
Before, like I want, once if Moriko indicates that that's the place, and on the shoulder, really quick before she starts walking off, give me a minute and a half. And I'm gonna look around and see if I can find. I'm looking for two things, Jack. I'm looking for what the angles of approach on this location look like. Where you might logically think to put people that might be watching the doors. And then how many actual, like, angles of, like, aiming, if I were to be sighting down a rifle, would I have once these doors were open?
You would have basically one angle of aim when these doors are open, which is through the door.
From inside. So the doors are like a foot wide. It's just like a foot wide.
Oh, sorry. Are you talking from the inside or from the outside?
From the outside. Like somebody outside aiming in, how many different like avenues would there be to actually aim a rifle into this building?
Depends what you're trying to aim at. The door is a bottleneck. So, you know, you've got basically about 10 feet wide. Mm-hmm. If something is very close to the door, it's only going to have to move a little bit to one side before it's completely out of your eye line. The building goes back a ways. So if they stay in the back and are more or less dead center in the building, you'd be fine. This thing has very few windows. almost none on the short ends, which is where the double doors are. So you might be able to, if you were able to take 20 minutes or so to get into a position, get a flanking angle on one of the side windows, but that's an even narrower bottleneck. Okay. You're going that's to have fine. Very little field of vision that way.
Basically, what I want to do is I want to find out where the best like point, if I were to want to be providing sniper support for somebody walking in this building, mm-hmm. what the best like rooftop would be for that. And then I want to find a structure mm-hmm. between me and it, like between those two locations, mm-hmm. where I could tape a laser to in a fairly discreet manner. Yeah, basically what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to use this targeting laser that I've got to mm-hmm. replicate an aiming laser.
Okay.
From half the distance, having just the laser stuck on a wall somewhere, so that I could activate it remotely and basically like hold up a hand at a specific like predetermined location of myself to sort of indicate, hey, look, oh, what's this red dot on my hand? I've got reinforcements outside.
Yep.
In case it becomes necessary.
Okay. That is something that you know that so you could do as long as you maintain position inside. It is going to be very, very difficult to accurately predict at that distance where that laser is going to hit.
Oh, yeah.
So it is a 1 in 10 chance that when you activate the laser and hold up your hand, that it is even remotely anywhere near your hand.
I just need to know where it's going to be on the door to have an estimate for where it'll be before it hits the floor on the inside.
That's okay. So you want to aim it at the door before you even go in.
Exactly.
So you can get a vague mm-hmm. area.
Yep. Okay.
The reason why I want to position it a little higher up is because if they mm-hmm. have anybody that can see laser light for whatever reason, mm-hmm. I don't know what gifts all werewolves can have. If they have anybody that can see that, I want it to be positioned far enough out and at high enough of an angle that the incoming angle looks like it might be real,
okay.
rather than just being, oh, you've got a laser point hidden somewhere you've rigged.
Okay.
And
yeah, you can attempt that if you want.
Yeah.
Eye of the laser.
You are aware, however, that one of the members of the pack's name is Long Barrel.
Yeah, I was going to say, while that's going on, Mordeko is going to spend a willpower for her whisper catching.
Mm-hmm.
For that supernaturally eavesdrop on conversations in particular.
Yeah.
So within 200 feet, anyone saying anything
mm-hmm.
is going to be fully audible to her. So anyone saying okay. something into a, like a, you know, headset of like, I'm yep. in position, mm-hmm. she yep. hears.
Okay.
Fucking Shadow Lords.
That's 200 feet.
Okay. So you turn that on as you're near the building. And immediately a number of voices arise. Most of them seem like they're around in some of the other buildings nearby, probably workers, somebody on a phone call in a passing vehicle, that sort of thing. Give me a perception and alertness, just standard difficulty, to see how good you are at narrowing things down and picking those things out.
To also to be clear, my assumptive stopping point for like doing that was mm-hmm. Marco has identified the building, not we have walked up to the building and then I
sure yeah yeah
away.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No worries. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay, perception, all, alertness, yeah. Alertness, eavesdropping, apply.
Oh, yeah.
7 successes.
Okay. You blot out the exterior as best you can, focusing your senses on stuff that would be originating in that building. And I think we've got a decent setup here. Mm-hmm. If they're out in the front range, like you're saying, probably be able to narrow it down. Now, the building is, of course, entirely destroyed. So they're certainly not where they started. You can ask around town, though everything's really rural and spread out. Might be easiest enough to just get our boots on the ground and do some good old-fashioned sniff and track, if you know what I'm saying. Doesn't matter. We will find them. And then we'll finally have some justice. however long it takes, we have the time. Fair enough then. Well, I'm going to go see if there's a coffee machine in somewhere in this dump heap that you found first. Go ahead. That's what you're able to pick up.
Yep. Mordecai's going to turn to Grania, and she's been staring in that way that Grania has become familiar with, where Mordecai just goes really quiet and just stares into space. They're looking for us.
I mean, yeah,
there's at least
soon, right?
Actively, there's at least two in the building. One of them is going for coffee. The other must be Isabel.
Only two?
That I can hear. At least two.
At that point, I want to see if I can spot Long Barrel somewhere.
Give me a perception alertness.
Using that same sort
standard
of
standard difficulty.
Using that same sort of analysis of like where would perception, where would I defend?
Yeah, where would you perception. Where would you post up a sniper kind of thing? Yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And Mordecai's looking for it because she knows that there should be more than two. And she has for perception, elf eyes, where she's really good at seeing things far away.
Mm-hmm. That specialty would apply.
What was the role again? Perception what?
Jesus.
Perception alertness difficulty 6.
Mordecai, what do your elf eyes see?
8 successes.
You do not see
the walls.
You do not see anything on the exterior. You're looking around. The exterior of this building is, there's nothing, there's no visible living things analyzing. You can see a couple security cameras around.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing on any of the nearby buildings.
You said diff 6, right?
But nothing, yeah, diff 6. Nothing on roof lines.
It's okay. Mordecai's got you. It's okay. I don't see Long Barrel.
Well, if you don't see him, unless I've looked down at the duct, looked down at the laser pointer duct tape that I had in my hand, think about it for a second. Better idea. And I'm just gonna tuck it in my vest and hands visibly empty.
I was just gonna say, yeah, no, Mordecai's gonna try that right of the questing stone on Long Barrel real quick then, because she doesn't see him, and that seems weird to her.
How long does it take you to do that right?
It's like a good solid like 5 minutes, I believe.
Yeah.
Because I have to concentrate and sit there and think about it.
So if I see you starting like right prepare, let's not worry about it. He's somewhere nearby. He's watching. Let's just assume he's watching. And actually,
oh, Mordecai's not going to. No, she's going to ignore this. She's going to do it anyway. No, this is one of those things where Mordecai does not go in with disadvantages. That's fine.
It's just you're just gonna sit there and stare at a wall for 5 minutes. Cool.
Yep. Well, yeah. She takes out her necklace. She puts it over the thing and she checks it out. She's just ignoring. She's just focused.
To
sorry.
Make it look not awkward. All right.
Yep.
I am going to like
4 successes, Jack. What is
4 successes? So let's. Is that a level 1? Right.
It's a
level 1, right? It takes a minimum of 10 minutes per level. So hang out for 10 minutes.
Yep.
And she's just watching. Yep. Mm-hmm.
In that 10 minutes, though, that she's concentrating, she will still hear whispers, but if she doesn't hear anything that sounds particularly horrible, she's going to just block it out. If she hears something awful, she's going to stop the right.
Okay. In that 10 minutes, there's a few just kind of like random conversational bits that drift over your ears, but nothing particular. You do hear one other voice on the interior in that time. Let me look here. Who do I have?
Check your vocal pattern notes.
Right. Yep. Another feminine voice, slightly higher timbre than the one that you had assigned to Isabel. Just asking if there was anything that needed to be doing.
And Mordecai probably didn't absorb any of that. It was just a note of like, didn't hear anything like Aiden or murder or anything.
Right.
Or like, fight. No. She
engage,
like,
right?
Yeah. No, or like, those
bring
guys
me my bazooka.
In the parking lot. Yeah, no, she would have just been ignoring anything that didn't come through. So no information got
I've got a line of sight on them.
Yeah, exactly.
As
yeah.
the suitcase nuke arrived, right? Yeah.
Yes. Exactly. None of that, she absorbed none of that information. So it doesn't matter what they said. And where's Long Barrel?
Long Barrel's inside the building.
Okay. Yep.
just being and quiet, then, apparently.
Yep, and then she's going to say, at least four.
When you building. Come to, the space around you has been decorated to nice. Make it look like you are just a stoned out hippie that's just been staring into space for an hour and a half.
She doesn't stare into space. She looks even more like a hippie because she has like her little questing yeah. stone yeah. over yeah. it, like dangling she's off dowsing. Her
yep. Right, yeah.
And so
yeah.
she's no, just sitting there like have, staring, dowsing.
I have gathered random cardboard, grabbed some discarded crayon, done some fuck really
there are
like
crystals everywhere.
Like self-made, yeah. like
she
like,
has like, a She really has a flower bad. In her hair.
Okay. You have really no idea bad, why, but everything smells like patchouli for
yeah,
some
reason. Yeah, no, literally. Like,
I fished okay. some, I got some dead fish out of a trash. And
okay. So with that done, Mordecai is stepping out of the truck. She's given Grania all the information she has. She's given Grania an opportunity to do something, and Mordecai is going to charge the building. And by charge, I mean walk quietly and politely up to the building, knock yeah. on it, and
I was
wait
really
for somebody
excited
to say,
from her. Go just to be
I'm
like,
gonna. I'm gonna grab a beer and a dead man switch.
There you go.
A dead man switch that is not connected to anything.
Anything, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And again, she's going to knock on the door.
It's your fidget switch.
Yeah.
Well, no, it's in the hand. That's holding, it's in the hand that's holding the beer.
Okay, yeah. That's so fair.
Yeah. Hidden by the beer.
Right. So, yeah, nobody so, yeah, touched my beer.
She knocks on the door. Politely, and she literally just waits there.
There's a brief pause, and then you hear some footsteps approaching. And then the door pulls back. And there's a woman there, very light blonde, brown hair, excuse me, hazel eyes, looking down at you.
Do I recognize Mordecai, this person?
Right?
Yeah, I was gonna say, she recognizes her, right?
Yeah, this is Prophet of War. Hmm. This
Prophet
is their,
of War.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Spelled
this is their
how?
Prophet.
Okay. All right. Just wanted to clarify.
Yep. This is their Philodox. Well, this is a little unexpected.
Noted.
Right. Come on in. Who's your friend? Oh, you're the one they met at the apartment.
Yeah. Long barrel. If long barrel's still interested, I'm really interested in seeing just how long that barrel is.
Margo's just gonna keep walking.
She just kind of smiles and angles her body a little bit. And Grania, you see a laser dot trail up and down your chest.
That's gonna say, yeah. Go ahead and tell the hardliners Philodox that you're willing to fuck.
I then return the favor by pulling the beer out of my other hand and holding up the dead man switch so it's visible. Go ahead, make my day.
The dot trails to the switch.
I was just gonna say.
Oh, that's gonna end exactly how you think it's gonna end.
So shooting a dead man switch is not the smart move.
Mordecai is going to stand and step in front of Grania with the laser on her and say, we are not here to engage in hostilities. Please stand down. I'm here to speak to your alpha.
Well, follow me then.
And she's going to follow.
I'm waiting for that laser to move.
I mean, it's on Mordecai.
I know, but it's still pointed.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Mordecai's just going to keep going. She's going to walk.
So you walk. Yeah. The laser swaps targets as you go.
I was going to say, if it hasn't gone down from Grania, yeah, we're she's just going to keep walking forward into the laser pointer, I guess.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. She's going to keep it off of Grania as the I'm here to negotiate. We're not here to do a dead man switch.
Mm-hmm.
And she is going to turn her head to Grania and say, stand down, Grania.
Put the beer back in my hand. I've been standing down. This is a precaution.
And do you have wits and empathy on high with Grania? Is there any point in this?
You can always make a roll.
Yeah, I was going to say, there's
I've got 5 dots in wits. I don't have a lot. I have no dots in empathy, but I've got 5 dots in wits.
That sounds right. Mordecai's pretty hard to read in general, but she's going to be trying to telegraph a level of annoyance at Grania that might be subtle enough that it might not be able to pick up, but she's trying, while trying not to telegraph it too hard to the people that are around them.
Hey.
So if you wanted to see if you can pick up how irritated she is.
Yeah, wits and empathy, which if you, empathy's a talent, so it doesn't matter if you have dots in it or not, you still get your full dice pool, diff six. Hmm?
Diff six. Zero.
Oh boy. Yeah. Nope. All right. So you can't, she can't tell that Mordecai's already annoyed that Grani already jumped the gun the second they walked in.
I had a gun pointed at me. The gun jumped me.
You were supposed to wait. You were not supposed to retaliate.
Prophet of War leads you down, though. That's my favorite Chuck
Tingle novel. Yeah, so, okay, leads her down.
And there are a number of little clusters of debris, barricades. There's a, you know, a derelict forklift, you know, a couple things like that. Mm-hmm. But the passage down the center, most of the stuff has been shoved to the side, and it's a big open area. And as you walk through this massive open empty space towards the far end of the warehouse, a door kind of bangs open in a couple of these little annex rooms in the back. And a tall woman, dark hair, steps out. A couple of scars on her face. You recognize at least one of them as a full-on battle scar, the sort of thing that you get when you go down and have to use rage to get yourself back on your feet and keep fighting. Grabs a folding chair from behind the door, bangs it open and sits it down. And somehow makes a folding chair feel vaguely throne-esque when she sits down in it. Mm-hmm. Well, emissaries. Fantastic.
All right, and now I get to roll for introduction again. Charisma and etiquette, or what?
Charisma and etiquette would be fine. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yep. So Mordecai's going to show up, get within a range that would be sort of considered an appropriate, where, you know, we're kind of like out of immediate melee, but she's well within that range where if Isabel was going to do something horrible, Mordecai could definitely get caught in it.
Mm-hmm.
But she's not like crowding her. She's going to do her very formal, exactly 90 degree bow. And she is going to say, Mordecai, Lupus, the Urge, to the Shadow Lords, I am here on behalf of my alpha, Aiden. Oh shit, what's his deed name? Dawn? Storm's Dawn Taylor of the Wings of the Mojave.
Your head tips back a little bit. You can see the nostrils flare just slightly.
She tipped back her head?
Hmm?
Okay. Sorry, Mordecai's a wolf, so she sees head tip very differently. This is a sign of submission.
Oh, wait, Mordecai's in wolf form right now?
No, Mordecai's just a wolf, literally all the time.
So Mordecai has seen humans do this.
Oh, yeah. No, she just, it's just one of those weird things.
Yeah, no, it's a weird thing, right.
It feels
very
weird.
They do that when they're trying to smell something. Yeah, but yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
Great.
While, just as a passive, while Mordecai is doing this, her talking bit and everything, mm-hmm. I am standing back and to the left. Very obviously in a guard position.
Back to the left. Jeremy, what's up?
And I am basically because I'm on improvisation mode because of the location. Mm-hmm. I'm just scanning the room for every possible threat I could find and every possible tool I could use if I have to MacGyver together some bullshit very quickly.
Okay. As you guys got closer, the angle seemed to shift enough to where the laser wasn't going to be able to keep tracking you because it was coming down from a higher angle. Mm-hmm. You can see some windows in upper floors up there. Mm-hmm. So that is gone at the moment. You're looking around. Give me a perception of alertness, standard difficulty.
Both of us?
If you're trying to keep...
I mean- Mordecai's going to just be constantly.
I'm doing this while you're doing your talking.
Yeah, she would have just come in every room she's in. She's going to be looking for everyone in there anyway. So,
yeah,
six successes on Mordecai.
Cool.
Diff six again.
Diff six. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Not that it's part of the role at all, but does my wits specialization for ambushes or any of my sabotage or anything like that?
Not in this case, no. Okay. This is just noticing things.
Two successes.
Yep. You can both of you, Mordecai especially, but both of you can hear some footsteps behind that door. So you know at least somebody's back there, you would assume.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Mordecai, go ahead.
Mordecai's made her introductions.
Yep.
Head the nostrils back. Flare a little bit. Interesting.
All right. And now I'm going to roll to see.
I know your father.
New.
He's not dead as long as some remember him.
I need willpower. I need a willpower roll. I want to say like at least six. Okay, well, now she's fine. Mordecai just says nothing.
So he is your alpha now.
Yes. And then
how corrupt is he?
Okay, hold on.
That just gets a raised eyebrow from Grania.
Yeah, as I say, Mordecai would probably have at least some sense of whether or not Isabella is asking about that from a worm taint kind of way versus like a
it's very specifically phrased in a worm taint way.
And she's been around Aiden long enough. When she's been sensing worm, has she sensed anything from Aiden that would be unusual? None.
I know it's your wild twist though.
Talent. Why are you here then?
This is where I'd like to roll that. What did we just say it was?
The something in etiquette.
Was it wits and etiquette?
Manipulation etiquette was what you're talking
about. You had said you were hoping for manipulation etiquette.
Yeah, because that's what's going to be. She's going to be trying to bargain. All right, she is going to spend a willpower on this because she is going to be trying really hard to do something that she has been. She has a set phrase she wants to use.
Okay.
And what difficulty?
It'll depend what you're asking for.
This is where she's going to open the bargaining.
I mean, how? What? Because her opening words will set the difficulty for how well this is gotten across. What sort of things work on this particular get of Fenris Galliard?
So Mordecai is going to have she's going to try the tact of. We're all the Garou Nation here. I'm here to bargain for time to handle a Garou Nation issue. How she expresses that is going to be dependent on how well she actually can pull this off. Because I have different ways that could be said of how well she pulls this off. Okay. So that's what it's going to be about. She's going to try the tack of appealing to the Galliard's sense of dramatic story as well.
Okay. That will get you a difficulty seven then.
Okay. Yeah, because she's going to be trying to phrase this as we're all in this together. And wouldn't this be a much more entertaining story for you? And with manipulation, I don't think she has any. Yeah, she has cold logic as a thing where she's going to try to have do the math here.
Okay, so two successes ultimately.
Two successes ultimately.
Oh, plus one for willpower.
Oh, if plus three, so three successes.
So three successes ultimately.
Yeah, okay.
All right, give yourself a three success line there.
Oh, okay, she's got her three success opening, which is the good one, where she gets to use all her vocabulary words that she has looked up in the dictionary at some point. I have come to you in the interest of the Garou Nation in an offering of our people's laws and traditions. Our pack
has entered into a hunt of the enemy of our people. The worm has come for us, and we have sunk our teeth into their neck. Our alpha requests that in exchange for us endangering our pack in pursuit of this annoyance of the set, while you focus your energy on the great recovery of our esteemed elders, that you exchange time. Once we are all victorious and sing the songs of our victory, he will accept a challenge from you while our enemies are dead on the ground.
Well, you speak well enough. And she interesting to see him now in leadership of a pack. He wants time. Very well. If I give him this time, there will be a limit. There is no saying how long or short it might take, and my vengeance is not that tempered with patience like your people are used to.
With that, Mordico is going to very slowly reach for that cell phone.
Okay.
And present it. This is from our alpha. To speak with him without fear that we will use this to our advantage.
She reaches out, takes the phone. You do know your father must have taught you. His actions are those of one who works with the fallen, but hides it.
Mordecai needs another willpower. It's dad. Oh, good, man. Mordico is going to look somewhere around Isabel's probably chest area, somewhere around like her abdomen, and say, oh wait, I want to do another roll for how good she can talk. This would be another manipulation etiquette. She's going to try to say basically, nah. what difficulty would that be?
Standard difficulty on that one, probably.
Okay. Shit. She does not say nah. She does, however, say, we are all misunderstood from time to time. And that's all she says. Actually, you know, continues to look not at her actual eyes.
Now, is there a number programmed into this phone?
No, the specific instruction was to give a signal, presumably over totem phone, when the phone is handed off.
Totem phone or Grania gives a text or something.
Yep. Okay. As I say, because I think we're out of, are we out
because
of
totem phone? Because if I give them a phone number.
You're not out of totem phone.
They can potentially track ahead of time.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
They could be just like, okay, I'll call them later. And then.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So, okay. So,
Aiden's not a dummy.
Yeah, no, Aiden's smart. Okay, so, but she has the phone in her hand.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. She's going to say over totem phone, Aiden, it is done. She has the phone.
Are we close enough for that?
You guys are within 30 odd miles at least. So yeah.
All right.
I assume Aiden would have taken the time to get somewhere with cell phone reception before.
Yes, absolutely.
Right. Smart.
Otherwise,
all you hear is shit.
Y'all are there for like 45 minutes.
No, classic Aiden.
So yeah. All right. Then he hits the low number programmed into this burner phone.
She flips it open. Blood traitor.
Isabel.
Don't call me that. I have given you a name, you know mine.
Apologies.
Can Moriko hear Aiden's side of this conversation?
Does she still have whisper catching up?
Mm-hmm. It's still in the same scene, as long as we're continuing.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can hear the little, you know how you can hear the voice coming out of a phone if you're standing close enough. You've got super hearing, so you can definitely hear it just fine.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm not trying to make this situation worse, but I'm trying to resolve this in a way that allows us to do what we need to do, and then I give you what you need.
And why should I think your word is better than it was a year and a half ago?
I don't necessarily expect you to believe it, because I don't think there's anything I can say that will make you think otherwise. What I expect is you've always been pragmatic. And you know it's going to be a lot it's going to make your situation and what the Sept is currently trying to do a lot harder. You have responsibilities there. If you have to keep trying to jump around and find us forever, we can hide. But if that's off your back and you can devote yourself fully to the Sept, as I know you probably want to do, and we do what we need to get taken care of, one of two things is gonna happen. Either what we are trying to accomplish, I don't expect you to believe this, but is in service, is trying to prevent something very, very bad from the worm side happening. Either we prevent that happening, or I die anyways. And if I prevent it happening, I will still meet you face to face.
I tell you what I see, blood traitor. One of us who walked alongside my sister turned corrupted by the worm, working in concert with the black spirals that slaughtered his pack. And now back, pretending once again to be on our side, finding a threat that he is supposedly investigating. But in all likelihood, we all know what your true work in those mountains is.
We can argue my innocence and your accusations all you want.
I know where you are.
You certainly do. Right now.
And I have two of your people
Grania just starts chuckling when she hears that.
Over the totem phone. Lie, Aiden. Lie. We are not important to you.
Bloodsbane, if you believe nothing else, believe that whatever you think of me, I know you are still fighting for the right side. And the right side doesn't murder our own.
Give me a whatever social role you think would be working in Aiden's favor. What is he trying to put into this? Is he trying to logic her into a corner? Is he trying to
No, he appeal is to her trying better to nature. Appeal to the yeah. fact that he honestly believes that she is a good, she is, for all she wants to kill him, a good person, and she's not going to do things that she would expect he would do.
Jack, give empathy. Me a no, because empathy is, this is an active thing, so you're going to have to do like expression, performance, I etiquette, will do one of those.
I don't have. It's not performance. It's right. not playing by rules, which is good because I don't have either of those. It's not line, so it's not service, so it has right. to be expression.
Okay. You could also go leadership, technically. It would probably be at a slightly higher difficulty.
I'm not going to try to pull rank on this woman.
Right, yeah, no, she outranks you, and also she thinks you're a black spiral. So, right. You know.
Jack.
Yeah.
Considering the way you, as the person speaking for her, said that line, mm-hmm. can I make a wits survival check to see how unhinged this person in front of me is and how likely she is to start actually trying to attack someone?
That would be a wits empathy check, but yeah, you can.
I would argue survival, because I'm not trying to care about how she's feeling. I'm looking for the signs that I need to survive an encounter.
Survival is camping and hiking and shit. Yeah, no, this is wits empathy to see, is this woman going to go spare? Yeah, wits empathy, difficulty 7. Because
I feel like you don't have to be particularly empathetic to be able to tell if someone's on a hair trigger, but I will.
Yeah, Mortimer doing the same thing, got one success.
And for Aiden, charisma and expression.
Okay,
and
here is an important question.
Yeah.
Three successes, four and if my ambush specialty applies.
This is one of those things where I've had very differing rulings from different storytellers. Could I have activated persuasion to work over the phone?
Let me look at persuasion real quick.
Is Aiden in private while this is going on?
Somebody at least had to probably come with Aiden if he was going to walk off for cell phone service.
Aiden is not in private. Aiden is wherever probably everybody is, because we were probably going to have to leave that area anyways, regardless.
So everyone can hear.
Just while rule checking is going on, when Moriko over the totem phone said, lie, you know, you don't care about us, lie, Sal just looks at Aiden and goes, lie.
And he would have looked back and he would have mouthed, not my style right now.
Yes. No, it doesn't say anything where you have to like be in the same physical space. So yeah, you can do it over the phone.
Right.
Charisma subterfuge difficulty 7.
Yep.
To see if you
he doesn't like the fact that he's cheating here, but that's not gonna stop him from doing it.
I'm so proud of you, boss.
Charisma subterfuge, and it's diff 7, right? Or is it 6?
Diff 7 for activating persuasion.
All right. I'll spend a willpower on this.
I taught you something.
So with willpower, that's 3.
All right. Persuasion is active then.
Yep.
So this lowers the difficulty of all ensuing social roles by 1.
Expression.
charisma expression. Initial difficulty would have been 8, so you are at 7 now.
Okay. And a willpower on this as well.
Yeah, he's got all the motivation.
Look, Aiden can do certain things well.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be 2 under persuasion rules.
Okay.
I'm going to child of Gaia this bitch into a green.
Go for it.
I believe in you.
Peace and love, you son of a bitch.
And that was 1 success for Moriko and 3 for me, 4 if ambushes applies.
Mm-hmm.
Actually.
She is definitely on a hair trigger right now. You get the idea that she's not going to fly into a rage and murder you guys. Most likely she would capture you and either interrogate or use you as a bargaining chip.
Mordecai, one of the big things is like Mordecai is pretty sure this is not going to end in a death. This is just going to end in a capture. So because of that though, because she did say that if they got to that point, she would run. Mordecai has a talent that requires her or a gift that requires a predator's arsenal.
Yeah.
That she can grow her teeth and stuff to think, but she has to concentrate for a turn. So I don't know if you want to call this like where she's just quiet this whole time.
You can start the concentration now if you want. Yeah. And within 5-7 seconds or so, you'll have toothy bits despite still being in Hamid.
Yeah. It's a bite and claws attacks in Hamid form for the rest of the scene until she dismisses the transformation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and she's gonna do that.
Predator's arsenal, you have.
Yeah.
With with my previous perception, or if I need to roll another one, when I was looking around, I was also looking around for things I could use in an emergency. Like, what's the room that we're in like? Stock?
You are in a big, vacant, borderline abandoned warehouse. There is, unless you're trying to improvise a stake to stab a vampire in the heart, you got shit.
I'm talking like. Raw materials, fire extinguishers,
wood, and like a derelict
forklift,
electronic forklift.
Swear to God, if you blow up another building,
that I can.
Oh yeah, no, Morgan is dying. It's great. All right, so yeah,
been 4 days. Jeez.
All right. So we've got that. We've got that. What's Aiden doing to get Isabel off the edge?
I mean, I said what I said.
Oh yeah, the right side. Yeah, the right side doesn't murder our own. Okay, so that's where we're at. Because we want to. We're at 9:08 or whatever.
Let my people go. They haven't done anything to you.
I would be within my capacity as a standing member of this sept to rescue these two from the poisonous influence of your deception.
But here's the thing. You know, and I know that you wouldn't be doing it because you're rescuing them.
Oh, I don't have to have the right reasons myself.
I understand that, but I also know that you believe in the reasons. The right reasons.
What kind of protector would I be if I let these two go back to you to follow you into whatever blighted crusade you are on right now?
Oh.
Make no mistake, traitor. Unless you stand before me in judgment and pass the tests of Gaia and blood, there is no chance you have to convince me that I am not speaking to my sister's murderer right now. And that's where we're going to end for the week.
Say goodbye, everybody.
Boy.
Bye, everybody.
Goodbye.